Catholic Channel, Sirius XM 129 presents Sounds from the Spires with Dr. Jennifer Pasquale, Music Director of St. Patrick's Cathedral.
Hello and welcome to Sounds from the Spires. This is Dr. Jennifer Pasquale and you're listening to the Catholic Channel on Sirius XM 129. And I have a very special guest here in the studio today. Very thankful she's come out in what's not so great weather this morning or this afternoon, wherever you are. Eleni Traganas. Am I saying that right? Traganas?
Actually, Jennifer, I applaud you for that very, very precise and correct pronunciation.
I got it.
Yes.
I was nervous. I said, and I forgot to ask you right before we started, Traganas or Traganas, but it's Traganas.
Traganas is correct.
Traganas. Yes. Okay. And Eleni is a fabulous pianist. I met her at a recital that I did, I think, almost two years ago.
And you played wonderfully, I have to say.
Oh, thank you. It was a half organ, half piano recital. And I have to tell you, Eleni, I had not played a piano recital in 19 years because when I finished my master's in piano, I decided, you know, I really wanted to be an organist. And I was an organist.
Well, that was hardly noticeable because it was truly, truly very, very well put together recital, very effective. You put some wonderful works in there, including the Chopin B-flat minor scherzo, yeah, which was truly wonderful. The Mozart sonata and some Liszt. I remember the Consolation.
Yes.
And the what was memorable, of course, is that you did one of my favorite processional marches on the organ by Alexandre Guillemot.
You have a great memory.
Oh, it's the bane of my existence.
And Eleni is also a wonderful composer. I've really gotten to know her more so as a composer, and I know she's a fabulous pianist, but we've been emailing back and forth ever since that day. And she has shared with me her music, and we have done her music, and we're going to keep doing her music. We have a concert in May, and Eleni is transcribing something for us into English.
Three hymns for the Theotokos. Mm-hmm. In Orthodox ritual, it is the Megalinaria, Magnifications, for the Virgin Mary.
Wonderful. And so, Eleni, are you a New York native?
Absolutely.
Yes, born and raised.
Although I am a first generation. Uh-huh. My parents both were born in Greece.
Okay. Yes, I'm first generation as well.
Yeah,
Filipino. And how did you get your start in music? What just drove you to love the instrument of the piano?
It was at a very, very early age, I have to say. And I was basically raised in the church. My father was a cantor. Mm-hmm. And I remember one day, I was 3 years old, and that, of course, the bane of my existence is this memory of mine. I can pull out details from very distant memories.
Amazing.
So this was on a Good Friday. I remember being transfixed by what seemed to be a row of organ pipes, uh-huh, in the back of the altar. This was an Orthodox church.
Huh,
and of course, as you know, the pipe organ doesn't really have a place in modern Orthodoxy.
Right.
So we were using a reconverted Protestant church.
I see.
And I remember sitting in the pews with my mother while my father was chanting, and I was hypnotized. First impression I ever got by these organ pipes, and I was lost. And before you knew it, there was a gasp in the congregation, and my hair apparently had caught fire. I was in flames. There were candles from some of the congregants behind me that caught flame on my hair, and I was thrown to the ground, covered in blankets, etc. And that was my first induction into the world of music and the hypnotic effects it can have on us.
Wow.
Yes.
At the age of three.
At the age of three,
and
yes.
You remember all of this.
I do.
Amazing.
Yes. Yes. And there happened to be in that church basement, a battered little upright piano in the corner. And I remember running to it automatically and picking out tunes that some of the parishioners were singing to me. So it was love at first sight.
Wow. And then here you are today, concert pianist, author, composer. And That view of the pipes that first time. Do you play the organ at all?
I did. I started at the age of 11.
Uh-huh.
My first paying job. Yes.
And would that be in the Orthodox Church or a Protestant church, Catholic church?
Well, I've done many churches throughout the years. Mm-hmm. In Greece, when I was resident there for 10 years, mm-hmm, I was working at Christus Kirche, the German Lutheran church.
Oh, okay.
They had a lovely pipe organ, which is, of course, now defunct.
Oh.
I've played on quite a few pipe organs, but it was a little more convenient to study the piano, mm-hmm, as we all know. We can't easily gain access to pipe organs or organs in general.
Right.
So the training was basically as a pianist.
Yeah. And where did you do your studies?
At Juilliard.
Uh-huh.
And? Composition studies at the University of Manitoba.
Okay.
Also, if you recall, the landmark School of Performing Arts, if you remember the movie Fame, that is one of my early alma maters, performing arts, where I went at the age of 14, and we had rigorous training in the arts, many, many opportunities performing compositions on WQXR, other radio stations, WNYC at that time. And the exposure was truly, truly wonderful for young musicians, aspiring young musicians.
Uh-huh. And do you have any connections with that school today?
I believe, we have the group of people who have graduated that we meet every now and then.
Oh, good.
However, I believe the school burnt down a while ago, and it was closed.
Oh.
It is now, of course, out of commission.
Wow. So you concertize. How often do you give concerts, and how often do you have to fly? And you're probably all over the place.
Well, flying is another issue. I had two near crashes in the past. Out of 150 transatlantic flights, the last two were near crashes, so that says it all.
Uh-huh.
I'm very cautious about flying, but I do work in the tri-state area.
Uh-huh.
I give concerts as often as I can. This year, this coming year, of course, we have the Scriabin centennial from the time of his death on April 14th, 1915.
Huh.
So this is a very big year.
Yes.
And I will be revisiting his works. I gave my first debut recital in Manhattan here at Carnegie Hall years ago with an all Scriabin recital.
Uh-huh.
So I'm going to revisit that and throw in some of his arcane works, the White Mass Sonata, the Black Mass Sonata, and the Sixth Sonata, which I brought here today, is a sonata that he wrote in 1911, which he very rarely, if ever, performed in public. He was terrified of it.
Why is that?
It was so dark in quality.
Huh.
It was surging in terror. It gave him nightmares, and he could only play a few bars of it, and he would turn away in horror.
Really?
Yes.
That's very interesting. Look forward to hearing that.
Yes.
I wish I had known that was the Scriabin year coming up, because I was in Moscow, and there was the Scriabin house there that we could have visited. But have you been to Moscow, to Russia?
I've been to Odessa. I played at the Tchaikovsky Sonata, the Grand Sonata there, and which was very appropriate since he did tour the area, and it was very important for him.
Yeah, because you play all Russian
Many
programs.
Times, yes,
yeah.
I'll give all Russian recitals, works by Glazunov, Lyadov, Arensky, Rachmaninov, and I gave the first performance of the original transcription of the Rachmaninov's Isle of the Dead that was featured in German radio, Westdeutscher Rundfunk, WDR, in Cologne, and that was for the Rachmaninov commemorative concerts.
Yes.
And I actually performed that a few weeks ago at St. Peter's Church.
Right, and I wish I could have been there.
I know.
Because Rachmaninov is my favorite composer.
I know, yes.
You speak German?
I do.
Yeah, your accent is great, very, very clear.
Thank you.
Sehr gut. So let's listen to a little bit of Mozart. Let's listen to Eleni playing. And this is the Romanze from Mozart Concertos, D minor, K466. So we'll take a listen to this now. It's produced by EMI.
EMI, yes, uh-huh. Athens. And it was recorded with the Israel Sinfonietta, Uri Meyer conducting.
Okay, great. Thank you. That's a little bit of the Romanze from Mozart's Concerto in D minor, K466. That is our guest today, Eleni Traganas, playing that piece, and it's the Israel Sinfonietta, Uri Meyer, the conductor.
Correct.
And that's produced on EMI, so that's available for people to...
It was released for the Jewish Museum.
Oh, okay.
And it is available
It is available. That, yes. If anybody's interested in anything we listen today, what's the best way that they can
You can find links to my music that is for sale, my novel, and everything else on my website, which I promise to update this week.
Oh, okay. ElleniTraganas.com. Traganas. Traganas. Say it for
Any
me.
Any way you say it, Jennifer, sounds wonderful to me.
So, yes, wonderful stuff. And we'll continue to listen to her music, both piano and some compositions that she's going to talk about later. And you also have a novel. Tell us about this novel.
The novel, yes, a culmination of my experiences in Europe. And in Athens in particular.
Is produced and is offered by Seaburn Books, Seaburn Classics. I wrote it a few years ago. And if you like, I would be happy to read a few passages for you now. And this is about Lara Sarafi,
the heroine of the novel, who is having a difficult time in her surroundings. So one sultry day shortly thereafter, she caught herself daydreaming to the mighty accompaniment of Bach's Passacaglia. She imagined herself seated before a pipe organ in heavenly inspiration. Giddy from the saintly heights, she was effortlessly soaring, higher and higher through the clouds until the overmastering glow of the sun's corona suffused her with indescribable bliss. She was playing to touch the innermost spirit of the living universe, sending out a force field of impassioned emotion and acceptance to all, and sitting alone in rapt, wide-eyed attention, in a pew below, was Aleko, with his ever-present, admiring smile. For hours, the thrilling organ tones vibrated and echoed through Lara's ears, loud and clear from she knew not where, from the powerful ascetic theme arising from the deep bellows of the bass pipes. From one variation to the next, the upper flute-like tones expanding and melding with intoxicating 32-foot stops screaming in her mind's ear with cathedral-like resonance. She was lost in her own world again, and Aleko was there with her as they rushed up towards the heights of the human spirit. The music would not stop as she sat in her bedroom preparing her morning toilet, etc., etc.
Wow. So if you want to know more about Eleni Traganas, go onto her website, ElleniTraganas.com, ElleniTraganas.com. You can see pictures, you can listen to YouTube clips, watch them. That's great stuff about the pipe organ and everything. And
yes, I'm an impassioned organ enthusiast. I hope it shows.
Oh, yes, definitely. And, I met you at my recital, and I'm very thankful that this collaboration and friendship has resulted as appearance there.
It was really a memorable recital, I have to say. And the thrilling pipe organ at Brick Presbyterian.
Oh, that's a
was
great instrument.
Absolutely wonderful. Yeah. Wonderful experience.
So 12th House by Eleni Traganas. And how can people get that?
It's available at Barnes & Noble's, mm-hmm. Amazon, through my website, if you would like an inscribed copy.
Oh, wonderful. Again, it's ElleniTraganas.com. That's Eleni, ElEni, and then TraganaS.com. You can see all the pictures. There are some YouTube clips on there. You can find out all about her. So many newspapers and articles that have commented on her. Some great reviews.
And many of my paintings, actually.
I've done, and you, how do you find time for all this?
You need projects. You need creativity is the way that you truly feel alive.
Yes.
The more you project your innermost self, the more projects you have to work on, the greater the sense of being present in life.
Yes.
I believe.
So we'll be back in a couple of minutes, and as soon as we come back, we'll listen to some Scriabin. You're listening to The Catholic Channel on Sirius XM 129.
The Catholic Channel, Sirius XM 129 presents Sounds from the Spires with Dr. Jennifer Pasquale, Music Director of St. Patrick's Cathedral.
So we're going to take a listen now to some Scriabin. This is Sonata number 6, Opus 62, and this is produced by WDR West German Broadcasting Company in Cologne Studios.
Thank you.
We're going to skip to the end of that because it's the recap and climax are really critical and exciting. So again, this is the Sonata number 6, Opus 62. Our guest today, Eleni Traganas, is going to share with us the story of this again after we listen to this sonata.
Thank you.
And that was a little bit of the Scriabin Sonata number 6, Opus 62. And our guest today, Eleni Traganas, is the performer on that. And that was produced by WDR, West German Broadcasting Company, in Cologne Studios. And that is, it sounds really difficult. It's all over the keyboard.
It is all over the keyboard. And it was a groundbreaking work for Scriabin and his style. This is when he embarked on his later sonatas. This was the precursor to the 7th sonata, in which he claimed to have eliminated all earthly elements, all earthly thematic, recognizable diatonic elements from his music, and where he claimed to have finally achieved his sainthood on earth.
Huh. Wow. It's great music, and I'm not familiar with the work, but you play it really well.
Thank you. It was a work that Scriabin, as we mentioned earlier, was truly terrified of. He wrote it very quickly, as he did most of his last works, with hardly an erasure. If you look at his manuscripts, especially of the 7th Sonata, beautifully written. Of course, Scriabin used to embroider when he was a child.
Really?
Yes.
Huh.
And it is astonishing to note that there are no erasures. It flows effortlessly.
Huh.
And it is devilishly difficult.
Yeah. How long? I mean, you have almost a photographic memory. You amazingly remember everything. Was this a difficult work for you to grasp?
No.
Pretty easy?
If you really love what you're playing, it's almost instantaneous. Huh. I do have a photographic memory, and it, again, it's the bane of my existence.
Oh, it's something I wish I had. Memorizing music is not my thing anymore. But
Well, I've given some seminars on that concerning chromosynesthesia,
huh,
and relating colors to tones, or relating all associations to the overall tonal expression of a piece.
Uh-huh.
And it makes its presentation a lot easier. Also memorization, mnemonic devices, but chromosynesthesia generally works.
Huh. And you give seminars.
I do.
You do. Yeah. And if somebody who's listening today might be interested in getting you to speak for a seminar, how can they do that?
Check my website.
Oh, wow. I mean, that's something interesting. I'm on the board of a couple of things. That sounds like an amazing thing.
It really is. And of course, Scriabin was a precursor, a genuine proponent of the force of colors behind tones.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we all know about Rimsky-Korsakov, who had his own color chart, and associations of colors and tones is very subjective, actually, but almost all, there's a general consensus as to what color, for instance, the key of C vibrates to, or E flat, mm-hmm, or B flat, or F sharp, especially F sharp amongst pianists, somehow resonates to the color of deep blue, dark indigo.
Huh.
I don't know how that is with you, Jennifer, if you have any color
associated. F sharp major or minor?
A difference there, too.
Yes.
But just the key, the general key of,
yeah,
F sharp itself.
Uh-huh.
Somehow, in my case, it resonates very deeply to a dark, deep indigo blue.
And do you think that some people don't necessarily envision the same color or hear the same tone with
they might
colors?
This is one of the interesting things about the seminar. We'll sit down and individually play tones,
huh,
and then play music affiliated with those tones. And everyone is given a color chart, without the colors, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And they are to fill in their own sense of what that color, what that key vibrates to as far as color is concerned. And very often we will come up with general consensus about the key of E flat, the key of C, the key of G, the key of D especially, which almost unanimously vibrates to a golden yellow color.
I was thinking of yellow in my head.
You see? Yes.
When is your next seminar in the Tri-State area?
Oh, seminars.
This is fascinating.
I know, but no, I'm really immersed now in composition. You know, I take one project at a time.
Okay.
When it's completed, I move on.
Okay. You know. So go to her website, elenitraganas.com, ELENITRAGANAS.com. You can see her pictures, you can listen to the YouTube clips, you can look at her novel.
And sepulchral watercolors of cemeteries.
Wow. What is sepulchral?
Sepulchral. funereal.
Okay, that's what I, yes. As soon as I said the word, I said, oh, I know what that means.
Of course.
Yes, and I don't know how you find time for this. And do you teach as well, in addition to everything you're doing?
I did teach. Mm-hmm. I lead a rather hermetic life, as you can imagine. If we're going to combine all the arts, we need a little time for ourselves to do what we have to do.
Right. That's great. I applaud you for finding that time. So let's listen to a little more here. This is the Nikolai Metner Fairy Tale, Opus 21, Number 1. And this is a live recording.
I believe that's Opus 20?
Oh, I'm sorry, yes. Opus 20, Number 1, yes. Recorded live, Greater Port Jefferson Arts Council. That was the Nikolai Metner Fairy Tale, Opus 20, Number 1. And that was a live recording at the Greater Port Jefferson Arts Council. Another very difficult sounding piece.
Very difficult, very dark, very challenging. And Nikolai Metner was truly a phenomenal composer, a little later than Scriabin, perhaps 8 years or so younger than Scriabin, but in the same group of musicians at the time. Pianism was at its height. And Nikolai Metner wrote several sonatas. I played some of them. But the music overall is rather dark. It's not that easily accessible emotionally to the audience. Some isolated fairy tales, such as the one I played, have an immediate emotional impact. But lengthy sonatas are a bit arcane for some listeners. So I've decided to just concentrate on Chopin lately.
So how many hours a day do you practice?
When I do have concerts on my agenda, approximately 4 or 5.
Goodness.
If I have to. Well, you know, it's you want to be...
Right.
You want that muscular memory in place. It's not as if you have to memorize notes, for heaven's sakes, you know. It's just making sure that that muscular memory is in place and that your fingers are limber and very flexible and elastic. And
right.
You just want to make sure that the circulation is flowing and that you are at one with your instrument.
That's right.
Yeah.
Wow, that's great advice. And in addition to all the concerts that Eleni gives. She's also a choral composer. Every Sunday you're at the Orthodox Church.
Yes.
Which one?
This is St. Mary of the Life-Giving Fountain in the Bronx. The Greek word for that, the Orthodox word, is Zoologos Pigi, or the Life-Giving Fountain. Zo, of course, meaning life, Logos, giving, Pigi, fountain.
Are you fluent in Greek?
Of course.
Yes.
My native tongue.
Wow. But you're firstborn.
Firstborn, yes. Well, we did speak Greek and English at home.
Uh-huh. Amazing. And so most of the compositions you do are in Greek?
Well, they are also available in English, as you well know.
Yeah.
But they are based on the liturgy of St. John Chrysostom.
Uh-huh.
And also from the St. Basil liturgy. Most of them are in Greek, but I've done some secular works too, of course. Piano compositions, works for a string quartet, etc. And it's just a constant evolution. And at the time when I was studying a composition in Canada, there was such a pressure to be very novel and explorative in your ideas. And I was actually writing music from the Byzantine liturgy using proportional notation at the time.
What does that mean to listeners?
You have blocks of sounds instead of individual notes that would approximate the length of time, you know, of each tone. So it was a very strong pressure that one was feeling at that time. But now I'm just writing what I love to listen to, and it's effortless, you know. And my choir sings this on a regular basis, and we also had a recent, few weeks ago, a choir federation. This was the Direct Archdiocesan District Federation of Orthodox Church Musicians, which had their annual conference at our church, and there were approximately 60 members. And
wow.
We got to do my first liturgy. I've written two liturgies, choral masses so far. And these are, Byzantine liturgies are endless. They go on for an hour and a half, 2 hours at least. So they did my first liturgy along with a published cherubic hymn of mine from the Denver Choir Federation. And we had a chance to do that. And it was a wonderful, wonderful, unforgettable experience.
Right. So this was a conference encompassing people from the tri-state area or the
tri-state
entire?
Tri-state area. Uh-huh. There were parishes from Connecticut and Long Island. And it was just a wonderful experience. Many, many singers, all enthusiastic. Mm. And we had a grand time.
Yeah. Is this an annual event?
It's an annual event.
Okay. Yeah, let me know when the next one is.
Absolutely.
Yes,
you will be cordially invited, Jennifer.
Because all I know is Western music, and I really would like to broaden my knowledge of all the music out there for all liturgies.
That is laudable. Yeah. There is so much out there, and it's an ecumenical approach, and my music is really being performed in many other denominations, too.
Uh-huh. St. Patrick's?
Yes, thank you, Jennifer. I am absolutely thrilled that you'll be doing the hymns to the Theotokos for the May concert. Mm-hmm. I really look forward to that. Of course, you will be getting them in English.
Yes.
All right.
So we'll be back in a couple of minutes and we'll listen to Eleni's choral compositions and she'll tell us all about them. You're listening to Sounds from the Spires on the Catholic Channel, Sirius XM 129.
The Catholic Channel, Sirius XM 129 presents Sounds from the Spires with Dr. Jennifer Pasquale, Music Director of St. Patrick's Cathedral.
Thank you.
and that is the Magnificat, composed by our guest today, Eleni Traganas. And in quotes, it's Axion Estin. What does that mean?
Axion Estin. It is a work that is written in honor of the Virgin Mary. And the translation is, it is truly right to bless thee, O Theotokos, thou the ever-blessed and most pure and the mother of our God, thou the more honorable than the cherubim and beyond compare more glorious than the seraphim, who without corruption gavest birth to God, the Word. Thou the true Theotokos, we magnify thee. So it is, it's truly right to bless thee.
Wonderful. Yes. And what percentage of works that you've composed are with organ as opposed to without organ?
Well, I would say 40-50% are with organ. Many of them are a cappella.
Uh-huh.
And because many of our choirs are amateur choirs, mm-hmm. who, of course, lack perfect pitch, it is essential to have an organ background for them.
Sure. You know. Do you have perfect pitch?
It comes and goes.
It comes and goes.
Yes, conveniently.
Hopefully it's there when you need it. Yeah. Yeah, wonderful. And let's take a listen to the Troparion of Cassian. Did I say that right?
Cassiani.
And this is, I'm not going to try to pronounce her name.
Olga. Wonderful soprano, uh-huh. Olga Xanthopoulou. And this is a work that is written for the Holy Great and Holy Tuesday during Lent. It is a work of atonement, of one of the more emotional works of the Orthodox Church year. And this troparion, or mm-hmm. hymn, it's an extended hymn of Cassiani, written by the words, actually, the text by Cassiani, who was one of the two Byzantine women to actually put her signature on her works, the other being, of course, Anna Komnene, mm-hmm. who wrote the Alexiad, who was the daughter of the Emperor Alexius. And she lived around 1000 or so A.D. So Cassiani was from 810 approximately to 865, and this is a work for solo soprano and women's chorus.
Thank you.
And that is a little bit of the Troparion of Cassiani. And that is by our guest today, Eleni Traganas. And we'll listen now to Enite, which means praise the Lord, again by our guest, Eleni. I really wish we had more time to listen to more of Eleni's music, but you'll just have to go onto her website to check it out, elenitraganas.com. And we'll finish out the day by listening to Clementi. She's a fabulous pianist in addition to a fabulous composer. So we will listen to Muzio Clementi, Sonata in F-sharp minor, Opus 26, number 2, a little bit of the first movement, Allegro con espressione. Thank you, Eleni, so much for being with us today. We will definitely have you back again and perhaps playing live in the studio.
Jennifer, thank you so much for inviting me. It was
a
pleasure.
I wish we had another hour. I could talk to you for 2 more hours. Thank you, Eleni. Thank you, Victoria. And stay tuned next week for Sounds from the Spires on the Catholic Channel, Sirius XM 129.
Listening to the Catholic Channel, Sirius XM 129.